I'd like to welcome everybody to the regular board meeting for the Village of Lisle Board of Trustees for Monday, January 8th, 2018. Clerk Brondike, will you please call the roll?
Mayor Pisak.
Here.
Trustee Boyle.
Here.
Trustee Carbalo is absent. Trustee Quitzel.
Here.
Trustee Dixit is absent. Trustee Hasse.
Here.
Trustee Mandel is absent. Village Manager Ertmode.
Here.
Assistant Village Manager Knight.
Here.
Acting Community Development Director Herman.
Here.
Finance Director Schiller.
Here.
Public Works Director Elias. Business Office Manager Deputy Clerk Curran.
Here.
Economic Development Coordinator Kelly. Staff Engineer Stormwater Administrator Suco.
Here.
Village Attorney Kraft Heffer.
Here.
Deputy Village Clerk and Recording Secretary Arnold.
Here.
And I am Village Clerk Brondike.
At this time, I'd like to ask everybody to stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And with that, I turn this portion over the meeting, of the meeting over to Village Clerk Brondike.
Thank you, Mayor. Visitors are most welcome to all Village of Lisle board meetings. Those who would like to discuss an agenda item may address the board at the time the item is discussed. Please raise your hand and wait to be recognized by the mayor. If possible, one spokesperson for a group should be appointed to present the views of the entire group. Anyone wishing to discuss a topic that is not on the agenda may address the village board during the open forum portion of the meeting. Speakers will be asked to step to the podium and state their name and identify the group that they are representing. There will be a 5-minute time limit per speaker. At this time, please turn off or silence all mobile devices. Thank you. And for our speaker summary, we have no one presently signed up for non-agenda topics, and we have two people signed up to speak about F2 as an agenda topic, Russ Whitaker and Louis Wetherman. Yeah, thank you. And do we have someone who is going to make a motion on the meeting minutes?
I move to approve the meeting minutes as presented.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
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 Any opposed? Hearing none, the motion passes.
And we have no raffles to present. And meeting announcements. All meetings, unless otherwise noted, are at 7 p.m. and located at Village Hall. Economic Development Commission meets on January 10th at 7:30 a.m. National Hazard Mitigation Plan Open House meets on Thursday, January 11th at 7 p.m. The next Village Board workshop meeting will be Monday, January 15th. Planning and Zoning will meet again on Wednesday, January 17th. And the next Village Board regular meeting will be on January 22nd. Mayor?
Thank you, Clerk Brondike. In my portion of the meeting, item A, proclamations, presentation, and announcements. We have none. Item B is the omnibus vote agenda. At this time, does any board member wish to pull an item from the omnibus vote agenda for further discussion? I don't hear any, but I would like to pull the item three for the purchase of a truck just to discuss other options.
I move to place agenda items 1 and 2, 4 through 6 inclusively as omnibus vote agenda items. Further, I move that all items be considered together as the omnibus vote agenda.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Will the village clerk please call the roll?
Trustee Boyle.
Aye.
Trustee Hasse.
Aye.
Trustee Carbalo.
Aye.
Trustee Quitzel.
Aye.
And Mayor Pisak.
Aye.
Excuse me, aye.
I move to adopt agenda items 1, 2, 4 through 6 inclusively on the omnibus vote agenda in a single group pursuant to the omnibus vote procedures specified in the Illinois Municipal Code.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Will the village clerk please call the roll?
Trustee Boyle.
Aye.
Trustee Hasse.
Aye.
Trustee Carbalo.
Aye.
Trustee Quitzel.
Aye.
Mayor Pisak.
Aye. Can we have a motion on item three?
I move a resolution authorizing the execution, a resolution authorizing the execution of a purchase order to Altech Industries Incorporated of St. Joseph, Missouri, in the amount not to exceed $95,573 for one new 2018 Ford F-750 truck with chip body.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. I will, since I brought it up, I'll start the discussion. Jason, I just had a quick question.
Sure.
I've been working with Joe Catalano in purchasing to look into a IEPA and a federal EPA grant for truck replacements as part of a VW settlement. Mm-hmm. Are you familiar with that grant at all?
A little bit.
Would this vehicle qualify at all?
You know, I'm not sure the status of that grant program, and I suspect it may not because it's replacing a Ford. It's not replacing an international truck, but it's something, you know, I would recommend, just because of the timing of this and the need for our chip truck, that if we're going to look at that, we've got plenty of international vehicles that are going to be up for replacement here shortly, as soon as next fiscal year. That would probably be a little bit more appropriate to try and replace them once we know a little bit more the timing of the grant program.
I don't believe the grant is limited to manufacturers. It's not limited to Navistar only, but again, the details of the grant have been difficult to ascertain. So anyway, I just wanted to be cognizant of that and see if there was any opportunity to
And I know our fleet manager is looking into the whole grant, the details of the grant too, and you know, in terms of what would be available to the village, we do, like I said, we do have several trucks that'll be up for replacements here shortly that I think we'll have no problem finding trucks that would qualify for that grant up to the maximum that we're able to receive if that's the case.
Okay. Any other questions, comments, anything? Okay. Will the village clerk please call the roll?
Trustee Boyle.
Oops. Trustee Boyle.
Aye.
Trustee Hasse.
Aye.
Trustee Carballo.
Aye.
Trustee Quitzel.
Aye.
Mayor Pisak.
Aye. And the motion passes. Next on the agenda is approval of Village of Lisle voucher list of January 8th, 2018, in the amount of $503,174.50.
I move to approve the Village of Lisle voucher list of January 8th, 2018, in the amount of $503,174.50.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Will the village clerk please call the roll?
Trustee Boyle.
Aye.
Trustee Hasse.
Aye.
Trustee Carballo.
Aye.
Trustee Quitzel.
Aye.
Mayor Pisak.
Aye. Next item on the agenda is an ordinance approving a setback variation, a building code variation for 824 Rolling Drive.
I move to approve an ordinance approving a setback variation and a building code variation for 824 Rolling Drive. And then I would like to make an amendment to that.
Do we make an amendment now, or do we make the amendment after discussion?
Okay, so there's not a second to that yet, so why don't you make a motion to amend, just to amend the ordinance as you'd like to now? So it's my understanding you'd like to, because this particular ordinance addresses two different topics, I believe what you wanted to do was split the topics into two separate votes.
The second, we will not vote on the second part of it. It's only the first part. We only need a setback variation. We do not need building code variation.
Okay, so what you want to do is amend the ordinance to remove the relief related to the second, to the building code violation, correct?
Right.
Correct.
Okay, so let's find where that is so everybody knows what we're doing.
Section 3B.
Okay, so section 3A would go forward, the setback variation, and section 3B building code variation would be stricken, and 3A would remain in and 3B would be out?
Correct.
Okay. So then your motion would be to adopt the ordinance amended to remove section 3B.
I move to approve an ordinance for setback variation removing section 3B B from the ordinance.
Yes. So then there needs to be a second to that.
Do we have a second?
Yeah.
Second.
We have a motion and a second, and I'll lead the discussion. Prior to the meeting, I wanted to get my thoughts out. The portion of the variance regarding the stormwater drainage, last meeting I mentioned that we can't legislate against Mother Nature, and so I was hoping that an engineered solution would take care of the drainage problem in its entirety without the need for a variance. The property has enough setback on either side, and the grade can be adjusted, so I believe you can find a way to comply without need for a variance. I think the variance sets a bad precedent for a newly constructed building, and I think staff can attest that there are solutions to it. So that's my point in it. Anyone else have any further comments, questions? Would they?
If I may, how will this affect the conditional nature of what we're doing here? I've worked closely with staff to come up with this agreement, and I want to make sure that, one, that we are going to get the certificate of occupancy, and if we are not required, because you are saying that there's essentially no violation, and I'm not sure that's exactly what you're saying, I guess what I'm getting at is what will be required of Ms. Murphy to get that certificate of occupancy?
Let me let staff give their ideas and see what we can address here and or shortly.
Well, I'll turn it over to Marilyn in a second, but there's an engineering solution, which Marilyn will touch upon, that we could still issue a temporary occupancy to address that engineering work, so that engineering work would still need to be provided, because as is, there is the nonconformance with that section of the building code. So the property still would need that work to be done to it to eliminate the building code variance necessity.
Okay, so the nonconformance still exists.
At the moment it exists.
At the moment,
yes.
It exists. It can be eliminated. There are feasible ways to do it with engineering and additional grading. Your engineer laid it out in his plan. None of that's been done as of yet anyway, but there's ways to do it and not violate code. And I think that needs to be the solution to the problem.
Okay.
Is that
so? The zoning variance we can't, of course, we fix. So that's where we have to issue the variance for the setback. But since we can grade and install drain pipes as necessary to resolve the building code variance, we don't need to actually issue a variance to the building code because we're going to engineer a solution.
Okay, does that mean that the zoning variance is going to be conditional on the building code work?
We're going to issue a temporary CO condition on the engineering work.
Okay.
And the ordinance, I believe, as the motion is made, pertains to the setback only in its entirety.
Correct. I'm just trying to make sure that we're all clear on exactly what's required of Ms. Murphy moving forward.
Mm-hmm. I think that sums it up. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Any further discussion? Okay. Clerk Brondike, will you please call the roll?
Trustee Boyle.
Aye.
Trustee Hasse.
Aye.
Trustee Carballo.
Aye.
Trustee Quitzel.
Aye.
And Mayor Pisak.
Aye. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next item on our agenda is presentation for a special use permit for a temporary leasing office at 1045 Burlington Avenue, Suite 4 for Marquette Apartments, LLC. And I think...
So real quickly, while the petitioner is making their way up, I did want to just point out that when this item was previously before the Plan Commission in December, it was approved on a condition that the temporary use of the space for an office be limited to no longer than 12 months from the issuance of the certificate of occupancy. So again, I just wanted to make sure that was in the record, that was a condition that the Planning and Zoning Commission had made.
Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Scott Everly with Marquette Companies. Good to see you again. With me also is Darlene Egan, who's Senior Vice President of Marketing and Operations with Marquette. As you know probably from your packet, we're projecting to deliver our first units for the project towards the end of May or early June of this year, actually. And as such, it's about time for us to really get started on the lease-up effort, which is why we're here tonight. Part of the success of that, really, we've found in our experience is dependent on having somewhere for prospective residents to come in and see and touch and feel the product, which tends to be much more successful in person than, for example, trying to do something digitally or virtually. So with that in mind, we set out last summer and fall to kind of research the market and figure out what the most optimum potential location for this temporary leasing space would be. And we've identified the proposed location here at the corner of Burlington and Main for this temporary space. We anticipate to begin our lease-up efforts in February and for the temporary space to service for about 6 months, though, through the end of July. At that time, we expect that Building 1, which is the building at the corner of Main and Burlington, will be turned over, which houses our permanent leasing facilities on the second floor. So at that time, we'd be able to transition into the permanent leasing home. Anything you want to add?
I think that's it.
I'll just throw in as well that obviously some important things that we look for successful leasing location is good visibility, good accessibility for prospects, parking, things of that nature that, compared to other locations that may be available on Main Street, for example, we certainly don't want to take up any of the existing parking for the businesses and whatnot. We want to make it as convenient for the prospects when they're coming to visit the location as well, and certainly being right across the street from the project itself bodes advantageous.
Okay, is that you're done?
Yeah.
Okay. We do have two people signed up for comment. Would they care to come up? Russ Whitaker? Wasn't that on F2? Oh, F2, I'm sorry. Okay, sorry about that. Okay, any comments, questions from the board?
I move to authorize preparation of an ordinance documents for a special use permit for a temporary leasing office at 1045 Burlington Avenue pursuant to the January 3rd staff correspondence.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
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 Any opposed? Hearing none, the motion passes. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next item is a special use permit for an electronic message center for Science of Spirituality at 4045 and 4105 Naperville Road.
Sure. Again, this is another item that had recently been to the Plan Commission in December, and while the petitioner is getting his presentation set up, I would just like to note for the record with this one, the Plan Commission's recommendation of approval was contingent. As proposed, the sidewalk on the property, which is on private property, sort of moves inward a bit as you head further north. The location of the sign would be between the street and the sidewalk. The Plan Commission's recommendation was that there be a revised location on the other side of the sidewalk, so on the east side of the sidewalk as opposed to the west side of the sidewalk.
Good evening, Russ Whitaker. I'm an attorney at Rosenova and Whitaker in Naperville. As Mark mentioned, there's a conditional recommendation coming out of Planning Commission. We've kind of looked at two proposals side by side, so we'll work through both of those and talk about why we think the plan as presented works well. So just a little background. I know there's some new members here. Science of Spirituality under construction has been for a couple of months. We're proceeding along. We're at the corner of Navistar Drive and Napier Boulevard here. Property is approximately 6 acres. This is a copy of the PUD plat. You can see the property and sort of layout. You're not able to see the mouse, but towards the top of the property, you can see the existing daycare building, which remains on the site. To the southern portion of the property is the new center, which it will serve for worship purposes. The center is well under construction. Basically, the outside structure has been built. There's some cosmetic detail that will be added onto the structure in order to get the look and feel that we're trying to achieve, but we're progressing along well, remain on track in terms of delivery, and look forward to opening in May of this year. Part of the reason I wanted to show you the PUD plat also is you can note up in the location of where the sign would be located, you can see that on the approved PUD plat, the sign was in fact identified. We'll zoom in here, and at sort of the upper left-hand corner, you can see a sign easement dating back to 2010, which related to Navistar's takeover of the property. The sign remaining there for Alcatel-Lucent or the daycare center. And in fact, there was a sign up in that location for circa 20 years before that sign was removed when the daycare exited operation. You can see sort of the brown area just to the left of the grove of trees there, which is actually on the street side of the sidewalk. Look at just a couple of pictures here. You can see sort of up and to the left, just past the telephone pole, the old daycare center sign, which is located almost exactly where we're proposing that the sign is located. The only reason we're before you tonight is we've gone from a static sign to an electronic message center. This is a depiction of the sign that we're proposing. The electronic message center is sort of a limited area in that larger sign. If you look at the words Science of Spirituality and Meditation Center, the sort of rectangle that looks like it could maybe be a TV space between those words is where you would have the electronic message center. Now, the village code specifically contemplates that uses like this, religious uses or public uses, may need different type of messaging to audiences, so they give them some additional signage rights in order to conduct that messaging. Science of Spirituality used that code provision before, but they had static messages that someone would have to go up and put up with pin letters. Here, going to the electronic message center is just a much more modern, efficient way of operating that is consistent with the character of the development that they're building. So when we were at Plan Commission, there was concern that, number one, the sign as we had proposed it wasn't 10 foot from the property line. The 10 foot setback is a code requirement, and there was, I think the Plan Commission thought that it couldn't be meeting the 10 foot requirement just based on the look of the drawings. We're showing here that in fact the sign is complying with the setback requirement and is 10 feet from the property line. And is further from the edge of the curb. You can see the edge of the curb sort of wrapping to the left of the property line. The other dimension we're showing here is 29 feet, which is from the back edge of the sign up to the area where someone would be positioned in a crosswalk. So we're 10 foot off of the property line and 29 foot from where someone would actually enter the road. So what we did is we talked to the engineer and we said, what does somebody actually need in order to operate efficiently? We know that there's been a sign out here for circa 20 years. The daycare was built in like 99-2000 timeframe. So we know that there's a sign that's been out there for 14, 15, 16 years. There's no evidence of any sort of traffic problems over the course of that sign existing. So from an engineering perspective, what do we actually need? And as you can see in this exhibit, based on the speed of the speed allowed on Naperville Road, someone would need 360 feet in order to stop safely before hitting a pedestrian entering the intersection. You can see the measurement where we've got we're well beyond the 360 feet, and in fact, we provide over three times that distance. We have over 1,100 feet of visibility, so sufficient area for somebody to stop a vehicle sufficient area for someone to stop a vehicle from the time that they were able to see somebody standing at that crosswalk. So based on historic operation and based on an engineering study of the issue, based on the additional information evidencing that we are in fact 10 feet and meeting code requirements, I think it's justified that the sign would be approved in the location where a sign was already approved as part of the original approvals. We have looked at an alternative design. The alternative design would require that the sidewalk is moved. So the sidewalk would be pushed closer to the road, which would be a change from the layout as it's existed for roughly 20 years, and a number of trees would come down. So part of our tree preservation plan that was approved as part of the original planned unit development required us to save the grove of pine trees that you can see just east of the existing sidewalk. Those trees would have to be all be removed. I believe it's three large pine trees in that location, which would come down if the sign was moved. In addition, there's a number of the relocation of the sidewalk and the utility work. We're estimating that the relocation of the sign is going to cost us roughly $35,000 as a result of the tree removal, the tree replacement, and all of the utility work that would go into it. So given the confluence of circumstances here, again, the sign meets code setback requirements. The sign was approved as part of the original PUD. Really, the only thing before the board tonight is the electronic message center component of the sign. A sign has been located in this location for roughly 20 years, and there's no evidence of a safety concern. And we've conducted an engineering study which shows that there is no safety concern. I think it's appropriate that the village approve the plan as it was originally presented by Science of Spirituality. If you have any questions and if you'd like to see the other signage plan, I can certainly show you that.
I'd be interested in seeing the other plan.
So again, we're moving the sign to the east here. The sign is the yellow box. You see the three trees being removed. You see the sidewalk having to be straightened out and pushed towards the road. Again, we can understand and appreciate that it's a little bit of a unique circumstance that the sign is located on the outside of the sidewalk or between the sidewalk and the road. However, based on operation and studies, we don't think it creates an unsafe condition. And given that we're talking $35,000 worth of cost in order to move that sign roughly 5, 6, 7 feet, we just don't think there's a good cost. The cost-benefit analysis weighs against moving that sign in a pretty significant fashion.
Are there any options to relocate the sign, keeping the sidewalk in its present location?
There are none. We have it kind of runs off the path, but there's significant grade along that sidewalk. There's actually a stormwater basin at that corner, so the backside of those trees grades down into a stormwater basin, which is protected by an easement that's been there again for roughly 20 years. And this is also the corner and the primary access point for Science of Spirituality. So from a planning perspective, you're going to want that message center to be located where primary entrance is. We're certainly trying to push people out to the stoplight. That's part of what made the daycare site very attractive to us a couple of years ago. Science of Spirituality has owned and operated the site adjacent to the daycare property for 20 plus years. When the opportunity came up to acquire that daycare building so that they could get access to that lighted intersection, it was really a game changer for them. So we've really focused on pushing all of the access to Navistar Drive and having our parishioners use this lighted intersection. And we think if there's anything that is done for safety purposes, it's getting people to use that stoplight as opposed to trying to use the secondary access point.
Okay. Any other questions from the board?
The new sign is how much larger than the old sign?
You know what? We got lucky and found the old sign on Google Maps the other day. So I couldn't tell you exactly how large the old sign was, but roughly 6 to 8 feet wide, 6 feet tall. So the new sign may be slightly larger, but I don't think it's significantly larger than the old sign. It's certainly a much higher quality sign.
Oh, yeah, I remember the old sign.
Yeah, I mean, we're proposing a masonry sign with an electronic message center, which I think is, this is the entrance to the Village of Lisle. And so, I mean, I think this is a very welcoming addition to Lisle, and this is a nice type improvement that will signify that.
What portion of this sidewalk is on public property then, if this change is made?
I don't believe any of it is. I think it's still, and as we look at the diagram here, this may be a little bit hard to see, but the
long and short dashes are the?
Yes, the dashed line just inside the curb line. You can see the curb line is solid, kind of grayed solid lines, and the dashed black line running along the curb line is the private property line. So there is, there's an existing easement that goes back a number of years for the sidewalk to be located on private property. So that would not, in fact, change.
And will there be restrictions on the electronic messaging as far as either the timing of the messages and how often they can change, things like that?
I'm not aware that the village has any regulations. I know some other communities do. We're certainly happy to work with the village on those type of things. I mean, this is developing a longstanding relationship with the village and working with you cooperatively. I mean, we imagine that this is going to be a sign of some public accommodation. So whether it's Veggie Fest for our purposes or some other village events, we anticipate working cooperatively with you in this type of location. So we have not agreed to any. The staff hasn't asked us about imposing any conditions on it, but I think that's something we could certainly discuss moving forward.
I don't know if staff is familiar with any restrictions. I think UTI had some restrictions on their electronic message sign, possibly by the tollway.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's possible those were put in place. I don't believe that the code specifically provides those regulations as it relates to an electronic message center beyond, you know, it certainly can't be a blinking sign or that sort of a thing, so that rapid change. But in terms of some specifics, we can look into what UTI or Benedictine University may have done with their electronic message centers, and I can work with the petitioner to maybe put something in place.
And Mayor, you're absolutely right. They're the only one who has established, to my knowledge, the only one who has established regulations with respect to electronic messaging is the tollway. So there is, in fact, and other municipalities have, Naperville has by way of example, but there are regulations about brightness, about the flashing, and whether something can be scrolling as opposed to a static message. So those things are out there. And I would say, as a matter of accommodation, to the extent that the tollway standards are out there, those are the type of standards that we wouldn't have a problem complying with.
I just think that the difference between a static sign and an electronic message sign is naturally, most signs are out there for informational purposes and to get attention. And the brighter the sign, the more moving it is, things like that, tends to take attention away from the less obvious, the pedestrians and things.
There's a brand new one at Nikki's in Naperville, and it's like a block from my house, and it flashes like "Congratulations, Cubs" in bright red and blue, and it's really obnoxious. So that's, and I mean, the owner's already working on scaling that stuff back. So I think there's some element of learning it and understanding it and figuring out how it works in the environment. But again, there's no intent to have fireworks going off on the screen or to have scrolling messages. That's what's been determined to be problematic in many instances, is if there's continuous motion. I think your code, in fact, prohibits continuous motion on other types of signage, but it doesn't specifically impose regulations on an electronic signage. So we would be looking at static images that would come up, would change at some period of time, whether that's every 8 seconds or 10 seconds or 6 seconds. I think that's something that we could certainly discuss.
Any further comments, thoughts?
I move to authorize preparation of an ordinance.
do we need open comment, or do we need to make a motion?
We can do the motion, then open comment.
Was Lewis, where?
Lou's with me, and we'll, I'll decline for him.
Okay, sorry.
I move to authorize preparation of ordinance documents for a special use permit for an electronic message center for Science of Spirituality at 4045 and 4105 Naperville Road pursuant to the January 3rd staff correspondence.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion?
Mayor, I just wanted to clarify if the motion includes the P&amp;Z recommendation, or as the petitioner has laid out, to leave their original location. So if we could just have if staff could have clarification on that.
Okay. Mark, you made the motion. Did you have a particular thought of which option you're?
The first option that Mr. Whitaker presented.
And Tony, you seconded the same? Okay, any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Hearing none, the motion passes. Thank you. Next item on our agenda is open forum. Nobody has signed up, but is there anybody here that wishes to speak at open forum? Seeing none, we'll move on to village staff. Item A, the Navistar TIF surplus declaration.
I'll turn it over to Finance Director Schiller.
Before you, you have a resolution that is deeming certain funds in the Navistar TIF fund as surplus funds and directing the payment and distribution thereof. This is part of the redevelopment agreement that was adopted in December of 2010, which essentially requires that the village declare as surplus the increment between the base amount that was established at the beginning of the TIF, which is the $25,985,520, versus the amount that was determined by the township assessor in 2009, which was $36,339,550. That difference being $10,354,030. So every year we do a calculation based on that $10 million number times the tax rate that's in effect for that tax levy year, and that is the amount that is declared as surplus. Just as a little bit of history, if you recall where that difference comes in, is that through all the TIF discussions, we were using the $36 million number that the assessor had assessed at that time. In the meantime, while we were pretty far along in the discussions, Lucent had filed a property tax appeal, and hence ultimately where that $25 million number, and that's the number that the county had to certify as the base for the TIF. So Navistar had agreed as part of the redevelopment agreement that they would, that we would use that difference of $10,354,030 as a surplus declaration. So that's what this resolution does. You will see on the exhibit that is attached here the allocation based on the prorated basis for each of the taxing districts that are part of this property. And with the approval of this resolution, part of this, we've also been authorized by DuPage County, the treasurer's office, to actually do the distribution ourselves versus the county doing it. And so on the voucher list of bills for the January 22nd meeting, we will be including all of these payouts to these various taxing bodies at that time.
Do we have a motion?
I move to approve a resolution deeming $833,250.92 in the Navistar TIF fund as surplus funds and directing the payment and distribution of these surplus funds to the appropriate affecting taxing bodies.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none, will the village clerk please call the roll?
Trustee Boyle.
Aye.
Trustee Hasse.
Aye.
Trustee Carballo.
Aye.
Trustee Quitzel.
Aye.
And Mayor Pisa. No?
Don't vote, I don't think.
Okay.
Okay, next item is the intergovernmental agreement between the County of DuPage and the Village of Lisle for shared geographical information system services.
Thank you, Mayor. I'll turn it over to Assistant Manager Knight, but this is just a carryover from, this was mentioned at the mid-year budget review as a shared service opportunity for the village to participate in for a cost-saving opportunity and as well as some intergovernmental cooperation with DuPage County. So with that, I'll ask Jack to go over the details of the IGA.
Sure. Thank you. Good evening, Mayor and Board. The resolution that you have before you approves would authorize the approval of an intergovernmental agreement with DuPage County. It would afford the village the opportunity to have a county GIS technician here at the village 2 days a week for 60 hours per month. The technician will support the GIS system currently in place, which supports the village functions a variety of ways, supporting staff's efforts. The agreement has gone, position that was left unfilled, the village's GIS coordinator position, was left unfilled from November. This particular agreement would help fill that set of responsibilities. It's also worth noting that the annual cost to the village for the GIS coordinator was approximately $82,572. That's with personnel costs and the salary and benefits accumulated. The agreement with the county would be a savings, which includes a $6,000 related cost to the personnel of a total of $62,263 on an annual basis. So just worth noting the savings that are incorporated here as well. I'm happy to answer any questions you might have.
Okay. Do we have a motion?
I move to approve a resolution approving an IGA between the County of DuPage and the Village of Lisle for shared geographical information systems GIS services.
Second.
I'd like to take the opportunity specifically to commend staff under the leadership of Village Manager Eric Ertmont for this creative solution that really brings tangible significant ongoing savings to the village.
Thank you. Any further discussion? Hearing none, will the village clerk please call the roll?
Trustee Boyle.
Aye.
Trustee Hasse.
Aye.
Trustee Carballo.
Aye.
Trustee Quitzel.
Aye.
Thank you. And the motion passes. Next item, policy prohibiting sexual harassment.
Again, I'll turn it over to Assistant Manager Knight.
Sure, thank you. the resolution that is before you currently is a policy prohibiting sexual harassment. It replaces the village's current policy that we have in place. The proposed policy adds enhancements such as additional definitions of harassment, detailed procedures in reporting violations, as well as whistleblower protections. The policy was drafted by the village attorney. And it is in compliance with State Public Act 100-0554, which required that the village pass a policy by January 15th.
I move to approve a resolution adopting a policy prohibiting sexual harassment.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? I would like to ask a couple questions. In the past, I've asked for a committee to be created for review of things such as this. I'm wondering if a request for another committee for appeal purposes would be warranted. Anybody have any thoughts or comments on that? Or a legal perspective?
Well, this particular policy has revisions that were required by a law that was passed by the General Assembly about 60 days ago, so it required the village to take quick action. We believe that the village's original sexual harassment policy was in compliance with the law as it previously existed, and this includes additional things as the assistant village manager has specified in it. And it does have review procedures and investigation procedures. The village board certainly has the ability to create additional committees or commissions if that's what the board wants to do, but that's a board governance issue. It's not really a sexual harassment policy issue. So right now, the way that the resolution is drafted, it has internal controls to make sure that if there are people who believe that they have suffered from sexual harassment, that they don't have to involve the people that they might be complaining of, and there are review mechanisms provided in here. But if the board wants to create an additional committee to look into things like that, it can do that. We would just have to probably then modify this again to try to figure out what the role of the committee would be.
Would we have to incorporate that committee specifically into this ordinance, or could we create a committee that would be possibly an ethics committee, a sexual harassment committee?
You have the ability to create any kind of village board committees that the board thinks it wants to have, but then what we would have to do is figure out what is the role of that committee. Is it an ethics committee? Is it reviewing sexual harassment? If it does have functions that would do that, then we would have to again look to see how we would have to modify this policy. So you have the ability to create committees to do what you want them to do, but I can't answer that question until I know what the village board wants to do with the committee and what the functions would be. So perhaps if you want to consider additional committees, you should do that at a workshop meeting and try to define what the parameters would be, and then we could work with staff to determine what implications any committees you create would have on existing policies.
Okay. So let's put that on a workshop agenda then to see what we can come up with. Other than that, any further discussion? We have a motion and a second. Will the village clerk please call the roll?
Trustee
Boyd. I'm sorry.
Oh.
This is all those in favor, say aye.
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 Any opposed? Hearing none, the motion passes. Sorry about that. Moving on our agenda, it's the village attorney's portion of the meeting.
I would just like to wish everybody a happy new year.
Thank you. And moving on to the trustees portion of the meeting, Trustee Boyle.
Nothing tonight, thank you.
Okay, Trustee Carballo.
Nothing, thank you.
Trustee Coetzel.
No, thank you.
Trustee Hasse.
Nothing tonight, thank you.
Okay. I'd like to make a motion, or can I have a motion to adjourn?
I move to recess the regular meeting and go into closed session to discuss pending or probable litigation against, affecting, or on behalf of the village.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Village clerk, please call the roll.
Trustee Boyle.
Aye.
Trustee Hasse.
Aye.
Trustee Carballo.
Aye.
Trustee Coetzel.
Aye.
Mayor Pisak.
Aye. And we're dismissed for executive session. Call to order the open session of Monday, January 8th meeting. Can I have a motion to adjourn?
Second.
So moved.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say no. We're adjourned.